In this lecture, we're going to talk about what happens after you pass your exam. You just got the congratulations. We're pleased to inform you that you have provisionally passed your certification exam. I mean, those are some of the most awesome words you can see on a piece of paper, maybe outside of winning the lottery. So you passed. All your hard work, your time, your effort, your money, it all paid off. High five. But you're not done yet. Yes, you have passed the exam, but now you need to get endorsed. For the CC, the endorsement is super simple. You just need to click yes, 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 no to a handful of questions where you say you're going to be ethical, you're going to follow the code of ethic, you're not a cyber criminal. Once you have done that, that is your endorsement. And after you're fully certified, now you need to make sure that your certification stays valid and current. For that, you need the two things we talked about already. You need to pay the annual maintenance fees. For the certified in cybersecurity, it's $50 a year. For any other IC squared certification in the US right now, it's $125. Again, may depend on where you live. Once you have given IC squared the money, you also need to earn CPEs. Those were the continual professional education credits we talked about earlier. And if you do both, if you do the CPEs and the AMFs, you should never need to take the exam again unless you let it lapse, meaning not paying the AMFs or not doing the CPEs. And the CPEs are really what you do to prove that you are continually learning about IT security and you're staying informed about what's happening in the field. For the certified in cybersecurity, you need 15 annual CPEs, a total of 45 per cycle. For the CISP, you need 40, a total of 120. And for the CCSP, you need 30, a total of 90 over 3 years. And you can obviously get more than that, but this is the minimum. So every year, you need to have a certain amount of hours of certification-related training. That can be webinars, articles, conferences, video training for other certifications, but you need to keep learning. And there really are a ton of different things out there that you can use to keep your certification current. There are two different types of CPEs, Group A and Group B. Group A is everything that's directly related to the certification. And Group B is professional development. Professional development means communication courses, management courses. It's some sort of professional development, but it's not directly related to the certification. It's all the other stuff that makes you better at your job. For the CC, you don't have Group B CPEs. For the CISP and CCSP, you can earn up to 10 a year. The rest have to be directly related. Getting your CPEs doesn't have to cost a lot of money. There is a ton of websites that have acceptable CPEs where you can go, learn something new, and then apply that towards your recertification. In the next lecture, I'm going to have some links to sites where you can go and get free or inexpensive CPEs. I, for instance, have a lot of students that just do the IC squared web seminars because those CPEs are automatically applied. Now, if you do something that's not automatically applied, it really is super simple still. I mean, it takes less than a minute to enter your CPEs. You go to the IC squared website, then you go to the member page, you click on submit CPE, then you type what type of CPEs they are, where you took it, how many hours you spent, whatever proof you have of this, and then you hit submit. Me personally, before I started training other people, I would do more training. I would go, I would find a video course that had a certificate of completion. That way you have the proof I completed this training. And you don't just get the one CPE here and one CPE there for the podcasts. You earn one CPE per hour spent. If I take a course that takes 25 hours, well then I get 25 CPEs. Most of the times, if I have the proof, I submit it right away, but you don't have to. There is then, after you submit, a small chance you'll get audited and you then have to prove this is the CPEs I took. Here then, you just submit that certificate of completion. So look through the links in the next section. Start on your next certification, use the certificate of completion from your video courses, but also here, keep in mind, you cannot start earning CPEs before the first of the month following you becoming fully certified. Meaning, if you became fully certified, that is the exam and the endorsement, and that was approved on May 10th, then you cannot start earning CPEs until June 1st. And with that, we are done with this lecture. I hope this has helped you answer some of the questions that you may have on what to do once you pass your exam and how to maintain your certification. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next lecture.